Jesus was all about the resurrection, right? If you were here last week, what you will remember is the Sadducees kept pushing Jesus on the feasibility of the resurrection and what that means. And this week, we have Jesus dealing with death and destruction. And he's not here talking about his death, which he is apt to do, but here Jesus talks about the demise of the temple. He talks about insurrections between nations, fragmentation in families, and he talks about our own death. And in some ways, it's a fairly odd trajectory for him to speak of the resurrection and then to speak of death, because death comes first, right? However, as I thought about it, it really is so Jesus to tell us about the resurrection first, because we need to know that. We need to trust and be assured of the resurrection before we can ever begin to possibly confront death. And I know it's not a fun thing to talk about, death and dying. And often I'd rather not talk about it. But there is also a very empowering thing in facing it. Our appreciation for the present that God has created is sort of sharpened and honed. Jesus talks of the resurrection first, because death isn't the end of life. It's just part of life. And I have sat with people and planned their funerals with them before they've died, planned their own funerals. And it's very, very clarifying for them. At the end of it all, we can truly begin to see what a gift life is. Hence, the emergence of the bucket list, right? You know, the list of all the things that you want to do before you die. So does anybody have one of these? A bucket list? I don't have one, like, written down. Like, I don't have, you know, like, on your bulletin cover, bucket list, and then, you know, 1 through 99 or whatever it would be. But I do know the things that I want to make sure that I do before I die. And I have sort of a lot of adventure things. And I don't think this is necessarily unique to me. I think a lot of people have one-time adventures on their list. You know, like, I would go skydiving, and I would visit India, and I would go on a hot air balloon ride. And there are plenty other of those, like, adventure things that I would definitely do. But also on my list, on my sort of list in my mind, are other things that would be good for me. Like, I would love to totally unplug from technology and work for a week and just be that. And I would like to get my EMT certification. And I would like to begin a foundation to help others. I also would like to have a pie fight. And I don't know why, but for some reason this is on my, like, good for me list. Anyway, those are a few things that I would do before I die. And if I knew that tomorrow was it, that was the end of it all, I would get started on that list right away. And it would take a lot of doing, a lot of endurance. But given my impending death, I'd find the stamina to make sure I got to it. And Jesus says this to us. He says in the reading today, by your endurance, you will gain your soul. And I think that endurance is an interesting word choice. That's how we live, enduring. I mean, you all know that I run. And I certainly did not start off running marathons. I started off with just sort of a few miles, and that felt like a lot of work. Actually, in the beginning, it sort of felt like I was actually dying. But however, the longer I ran, the more I could run. And the greater my capacity to breathe, and the stronger I felt. But I had to work at it. It didn't just come to me. Which is curious to think about in discovering your soul. That maybe we have to develop the capacity to truly live. I don't know that we think about life that way often. So as I read this week's gospel, I wondered about how the people Jesus was talking to, how they felt. Because what he says to them, he says, your church is dying, your communities are broken, and your life is short. I mean, that's, you know, Jesus says it a little bit more poetically than that, or the writer of Luke does, but that's sort of the Cliff Notes version of all those verses that he says. He throws all this at them, and then he says, but the good news is, you will gain your soul. And I sort of feel like, great. Now, I think we could all hear this as, well, once you get to heaven, it's all going to be hunky-dory. Everything that's gone wrong in your life, it'll all be worth it. And I guess that that's one interpretation, but it isn't all there is to it. Jesus does say that some of you will be put to death on account of me, but mostly he seems to imply that discovering your soul is something that you do before you kick the bucket. So as I think back to my bucket list from a God perspective, it feels a little bit narrow. I felt like life is probably more than a one-time jump from an airplane. Although I'm still going to do that, but there's more to life than that. And when I receive the reality that my life is not actually mine, but has been gifted to me from God, then different questions arise, or different answers to what the bucket list arise are. And I think that those questions, those God bucket list questions, are really important to talk about. But at first, before we talk about those, there's one interesting dichotomy which arises on most bucket lists. They almost all contain two things: risk and health. Skydiving, risk. Time away, health. And in some ways, I think these are the keys to any bucket list. Take a risk. Leave nothing to regret. Because in doing so then you gain your soul. You gain your life. But when we're faced with crises in our lives, we do the exact opposite of that. We hunker down, we hold on, and we try to keep things as stable as possible. When we do all of that, we sort of suck out the possibility for life. And we miss what God's calling us to next. Jesus knows that we're going to feel threatened and betrayed and hated. Jesus knows that we're going to feel forgotten. And he knows that all of that is going to scare us. When Jesus lays it all out there rather bluntly, what he's trying to do is offer hope. In their hour of doubt and need, he names their reality. And then he says, so how shall we live now? So I'm going to lay it out there. There are plenty of changes that we are all facing now. As a congregation, as a community, in our families, and in our individual struggles. And I don't know how now our now is so different than back then. What if we did ask that question that underlies Jesus' words today? What if we died tomorrow? How would we live now? I mean, if we actually trusted Jesus' promise that he's going to protect us, if we trust his confidence in us and his promise of resurrection, that life will always rise up. And wouldn't we imagine more? We could live like we were dying. Sort of like, if you know country music, Hat Tip to Tim McGraw. But I actually want us to do something different today. And I want you guys to write the rest of the sermon. And this is not me trying to get out of it at all. But I have bucket list questions for you all. And they're all around the sanctuary. And the questions are, before I die, I wish this church could. A memory that I hold dear. I need someone to pray for, and I wish I had made more time for. And I want you to think, because what Jesus would say is the kingdom is at hand. Now is not the time to roll over and die. Now is the time to dream and take risks for Jesus' sake. So this is what we're going to do. You can go to any or all of the banners. And I want you to listen what God has in your heart. There are markers below all these banners. And I want you to write down an answer in relation to these. And I want you to think. And during that time, I'm not going to rush you. I will turn on some music. And you guys, for the next bit of time, are going to answer these questions about how you would live as a congregation and as a person if this was it. And it might be hard. And it might be uncomfortable. And it might hurt a little bit. And Jesus never said it wasn't going to be hard. And while you're doing that, while you're writing, don't forget the two key elements are risk and help. A good bucket list has those. So off you go. I'll turn on the music.
Thank you. Can you lift you up? I know you want to bring it. Okay, let's go down there. Yeah, you can do that. Hold that. There.
So you know what you guys just did? You finished my sermon, you did. You leaned into the grace of upheaval. You said, before I die, this is what I will do. And you faced it. You said, this is what I wish this congregation would do. And you faced it. And you also said, these are things that are really important to me. And I haven't read all of them, but I'm pretty sure none of them have anything to do with, I'm really glad I sat at home in my chair all day. I only read a couple of them, and there are many things that I wish, but I also wish that this church is here when Sophie gets married. This is our chance to testify, and these are your words. How you will testify. This right here on these walls are part of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because maybe at the end of everything, what I think all of us most want to know, we want the world to know, is that we lived for God.